Okay, unfortunately, due to the power supply problem, I'm not giving you the slide today, but I will discuss a very important topic. And when the things will go fine, I'll definitely share you the slides for this session. So, in the last couple of sessions, we have seen that what is a network and what are the basic components of data communication system. So basically, we have seen that a network is composed of some hardware and the software part. Basically, hardware part means your network interfaces, which enable a system to connect to a network, and the communication links, which takes data from one device to other device, and the protocols. These protocols are nothing but the set of instructions or the rules which govern the data communication. So these protocols are nothing but the softwares or the programs. We basically implement protocols in terms of different high-level programming languages. So a network essentially composed of your software part as well as the hardware part. So from starting from writing of a message to its delivery to the destination, it come across many intermediary devices or internetworking devices, which we call in networking language hops. So the data moves from different hops to hops, and eventually it reaches to the destination. For making these things possible, network provide us a lot of functionalities. So all these functionalities that a network provide for making this communication or for making this remote communication possible requires a standard to organize these networking facilities or networking services. And one of the standard is our open system interconnection model, or we can say OSI model. Today we will discuss two important models, that is called networking model, that is OSI model and TCP/IP model. Before going to the OSI model, let me give you what is the requirement of a communication architecture. Okay, then we will discuss about what is the OSI architecture. Let us take a very simple example that where you can visualize what is how the communication process is really a complicated one. We all are conversant with postal system. Is a very basic communication system that we have seen from our childhood. In our postal system, if you want to send a letter to your friend, then what you do? First, you have to take a piece of paper, then a pen, then write your letter or write your text inside on that paper. Then you wrap up that paper inside an envelope. Then you take the envelope to the post office, put it inside a post box. Then the postman will carry that, your letter, and it again submit it to a carrier. So that carrier may be a mail van, maybe a railway system, maybe a flight. So three important carriers are there which are being used in the postal system. It may be a mail van, like a truck or a van or any road transport system, or it may take different mail trains. The mail trains are also taking the postal informations, and it may take a flight. Okay, so these are the carriers. Now, if your friend that to whom you are sending your message is residing at a village, so letter would reach to the district head post office, then it will reach to the city post office, then eventually it will reach to your village post office where your friends resides. Then finally, the postman of your village post office will take it to your friend's doorstep. So this is how our postal communication system happens. So we can visualize now the communication system involves a lot of functionalities. It needs functionalities from the how to write and where to write. Okay, because then only we came across the envelope or postcard type of things. So where to write is also, and where to wrap up the things also given by the postal system. Otherwise, how could you know about the envelope or the postcard? Then where to drop the letter? Also, they have a physical structure that is called post box, because in the post box we have to drop our letter. Then there is a physical employee who can take the letter. Okay, then your different carriers are there, like mail vans, trains, or like that. So, in a looking very simple, the postal system, but the intrinsic or the difficulties are higher. Because if I am taking you to the deep of the postal system, you can see that how a mail van can find a route to deliver the your letters. And if in a route there is a single letter only, can a mail van carry a single letter to that route or to that location? That is a challenge also. Postal system face. Okay, whether full or tens of letters or thousands of letters. Is one letter, it also reached to the destination. There is a question, because a lot of fund involved there also, because taking quotation and other part of the things. So looking very simple, a postal system involves much more complex functions. Okay, likewise, when we are dealing with our networking and data communications, there are a lot of network functionalities involved for moving or delivering data from one location to other location. Now, these functionalities must be taken care of, must be think before designing the actual or the physical network models. So the network designers, how before designing a network model, first they have to make experiments that if I am sending a single bit of information, as I have already mentioned, the fundamental unit of a data or information is a bit. Okay, so when we send a bit of information from one location to other location, then what are the functionalities needed for sending a simple bit of information? Okay, then they group together these functionalities and they try to design a network model. Okay, in 1984, the committee was approved the OSI model as the reference network architecture. So OSI model came into picture in 1984, and still it is termed as the reference model for any data communication system. So whenever a new data communication systems or new models are designed, they must follow the rules and regulations defined in the OSI model for the data communication. And OSI model is also called, that is, open systems interconnection model. It is also called a layer-based model. It has 7 layers. So what does it mean actually? 7 layers means the entire network functionalities are divided into 7 modules. Okay, so these 7 modules are called the 7 layers. Okay, so we have 7 layers, I can say, from bottom to top. That is, the first layer is called the physical layer, the second layer is called data link layer, third layer is called our network layer, Fourth layer is transport layer. Fifth layer is our session layer. And sixth is the presentation layer. And seventh is the application layer. So these are the seven layer architecture that OSI has given to us for the data communication systems. Okay. So one thing is clear that whenever we are dealing with such a huge, network which spans over the entire world, then we must need a complete architecture and complete structure where the data from one system, the system may be present at any location of the world, can send data to another system which is present at any location of the world. So in order to, making this type of communication possible, we must need this architectural model, and that is our OSI model, and which is a seven layer model. Okay. So let's come to the functionalities given by each layer one by one. Okay. The first layer is our, as I have mentioned, is physical layer. Okay. You may note it down, because today I have no slide. Some problem is happening with my backup. If the backup will come, I'll definitely show you all the slides and I will share you the slides. So let me today, I'll discuss about these models. If possible, at other times, I will show you the slides and I'll show you different examples. But let me discuss about this OSI model so that I will give you a picture so you can visualize what I am actually telling to you. Okay. So let's discuss about the physical layer. Okay, so physical layer is responsible for electromechanical specification of the interfaces and the communication links. Okay, as I have already mentioned, the basic things for making a device to connect with a network is the interface. Unless you have an interface in your device cannot be connected with the network. The interface may be support or may support where or may not support where. It may be a wireless interface or it may be a wired interface. Okay, I have already shown you a wired interface, that is the RJ45 interface, where you can connect your LAN cable, that is your Cat5 cable. Your LAN cable has a RJ45 connector which connect to the RJ45 interface of your laptops. So that is the interface where you can connect with the network or the internet. Okay. Another interface is the wireless interface. That is, in your laptop, if you have seen, there is a wireless switch or button. You can click on that button so that your system will be enabled to connect to the wireless or Wi-Fi network. Wireless is popularly known as Wi-Fi network. So whenever you want to connect to a network, your device must have interfaces. Okay, so what should be the characteristics of the interfaces? It is defined by the physical layer. Okay, that's why it is called the physical layer specify the electromechanical specification of the network, interfaces and the media. So it's all about interfaces, that the interface structure and how an interface should be, made. It all the specifications are given by the physical layer. Now come to the link. Okay, so whenever we are talking about link, links are of again two type, either wire or wireless link. So in wire link, we have three different types of wire possible. That is twisted pair cable, coaxial cable, and fiber optic cable. If we are having these three type of cable, then these three type of cable having different type of signals. Basically, the signals may be of electrical signal or the light signal. Okay, so inside the optic fiber, generally light signals are being delivered, or light signals passes across. But in case of UTP cables, that is twisted pair, unshielded twisted pair cable, UTP means unshielded twisted pair cable. Okay, so UTP cables, you will find the electrical signals. So physical layer defines these signalings. And what is the voltage level? Okay, it defines when the voltage level changes. It defines also what is the distance between the two devices. Okay, so if the distance increases, your signal strength may decrease. So the physical layer must define what is the distance so that you can the signal shape cannot be changed. We will discuss in our second module, that is data and signal, where I will teach you how a signal shape can be changed and how we can preserve the signal shape by using some amplifiers. But physical layer, for the time being, we can understand that physical layer is responsible for how for what should be the distance between the two neighboring host or two neighboring hop. Okay, for your visualization, let me again give you a very practical example that what should be the distance between two towers. When we are defining or installing, when the telecom companies install the towers, they must have a mechanism where they have to define what is the maximum distance between two towers. Because if the distance increases, the signal shape decreases. If the signal shape decreases, we'll see that there must the data may be corrupted or data may be changed. Okay, so these specifications should be given by the physical layer. Another important thing that physical layer give that representation of the bits. That is when the information is prepared inside our system, then basically our system has the functionality that the things that we write, for example, the text we have written in the high level language, that is called, suppose English language, it is called the high level language. We write just hi, HI. Our system has the provision to convert this HI into a stream of bits. So inside our system, the high level text is converted into the bits. There are, the compilers, assemblers are there, which are already installed inside our computer. So now high is converted into a stream of 16 bits, for example. Now, but the carrier only transmit the signals. So eventually, these bits or stream of bits needs to be converted into signal so that it can pass across a medium. So physical layer so responsible for conversion of bits into signal. So we will discuss many techniques for conversion of bits into our. We will study that signals are of two types: either it is an analog signal or is a digital signal. So we have different mechanisms for converting the bits into analog signal and the bits into digital signals. In different applications, we require digital signals to be transmitted across a medium, and some other application we require analog signal to be transmitted across a medium. There are also mechanisms where we can convert the digital signal into analog signal. Okay, so we'll discuss in the signal systems, but it is the responsibility of the physical layer to convert these bits into signals. That is called the representation of the bits. Another functionality is the synchronization of the bit. Synchronization of the bit means the sender clock should be synchronized with the receiver clock. What does it mean? Let's take an example. For our system must possess a clock. Even though we are using a mobile phone, we must have a clock. Even though we are using a laptop or desktop, we have a clock. Okay, and this is called the system clock, not the clock that we are seeing or visualizing or the time that we are setting. It is not that clock. It is actually, I am telling about the system clock. Okay, because the system clock responsible for the timing management. That is an important concern that is called timer management. For example, you are sending a message at a, your system sends a message at a, the time, let's say it is 10:01. The receiver machine at the same time, the receiver machine clock or the system clock of the receiver must have the same time. Otherwise, there will be a timing difference or a timing confusion may happens. How can we calculate how much time it takes, or how our system can calculate how much time the bits take from one location to other location if the clocks are of different? Suppose your clock is 1 second faster than the receiver clock, then receiver cannot distinguish that whether I have got the I have got the information in time or not, or whether there is a delay or not, because your clock is already delayed and the receiver sender clock is already faster. So you think that I have got the message very fast. Okay, so in order to solve that problem, the physical layer equipments are designed in such a way that the sender clock should be synchronized with the receiver clock so that none of them would confuse in a communication. The timing confusion should not be there. Okay, that is called the synchronization of the bits. So the synchronization aspect is taken care when the physical interfaces or the links are designed. Yeah. So next functionality given by the physical layer is the link configuration. We have already discussed that the links may be of two type. One is point-to-point link or the multi-point link. Okay. So these point-to-point and multi-point connections and the associated rules, okay, are defined by the physical layer. We have already studied that point-to-point link is dedicated between two stations only, so traffic can travel between the two stations which are connected in the point-to-point link. So no other station can share that link. So that rules or that definition is given by the physical layer. So whenever there is a so whenever there is a a point-to-point link, so that the link must be take data from the connected device only. The same case in case of shared link, the shared link can be shared by multiple device, which is the specification of the physical layer. So link configurations are also a part of the physical layer specification. Okay, then also we have discussed about the data flow. That is, data flow are of three types, that is simplex, full duplex, or half duplex. So whether a link is half duplex or full duplex, it is also a part of the physical layer specifications. So the links are being designed as the full duplex link or the half duplex link is given by the physical layer. Okay, so these are the functionalities, and another thing is network topology. Okay, we have defined many network topology, how to connect multiple systems across a network. We have studied about mesh topology, star topology, bus topology, ring topology, and hybrid topology. So these topologies are also the part of the physical layer specifications. So basically, if these are the functionality that I have discussed about the physical layer. Okay, so physical layer basically specify the electromechanical specification of interfaces and the communication link of a network. Okay, the first functionality that we have studied about the link type and the media type that is being used in a network should conform the physical layer specifications. It must ensure that if the link is of fiber optic type, then the signal transmitted should be the right signal. If it is of UTP cable, then the signal transmitted should be the electrical signal. So this signal and what is the voltage level, basically when a signal transmitted across a medium, then we'll see in the coming classes that the actually signal gives some voltage level. Okay, every signal has some voltage level and they also dissipate some energy. Okay, so what is the voltage level and how this voltage level changes, okay, or when this voltage level changes, that should be the specification of this physical layer. Okay, then representation of bits, that is how the bits should be converted into signal, and the vice versa, signal can be converted to the bits, because in the receiver side the signals would ultimately convert to the bits. So this representation of bits is also a part of the physical layer functions. Okay, then the network topology, the specification of the network topology, specification of the data flow, that is what should be the data flow, that is whether it is hubduplex, full duplex, or simplex. Basically, simplex is not of use in the network. It's very rarest we can use simplex method, whether we can use go for hubduplex or the full duplex. So all these specifications are the part of the physical layer. Then what should be your link configuration, whether it is a point-to-point link or a multi-point link. So link configuration is also the part of the physical layer functionalities. Again, important thing is the data rate. Okay, so data rate also, the physical layer also specifies what should be the data rate, because data is moving. And so data rate is what? The number of bits, okay, transmitted across the medium per second. Okay, so the data rate is completely depend on the medium. And okay, medium is a part of the physical layer specification. So data rate is also part of the physical layer specification. So data rate defines that what is the maximum bit rate? What is the maximum number of bits or the information that a medium can transmit it per unit of time? It may be a second, maybe nanosecond, maybe microsecond, whatever may be the specification given by different vendors or different companies, which are actually manufacturing the physical devices. So basically, we can use that the number of bits transmitted per unit of time. That unit may be second, maybe minute, maybe microsecond, maybe nanosecond, whatever. According to the specification, it may varies. Okay, so data rate is also the part of the physical layer specifications. Okay, so I guess you can understand that what is the physical layer and how we can implement the physical layer. Okay, so if somebody will ask that in OSI model, what is the significance of physical layer, you may tell what are the functionalities given by the physical layer. And somebody will ask that how physical layer of OSI model is practically implemented, then you can say the all the cablings that you are watching in a network are part of the physical layer. The interfaces that is inside our networking devices, like our mobile phone or the laptop or the desktop, all these interfaces are the physical implementation of the physical layer. Okay. Now come to the second layer, that is our data link layer, which is another important layer. Okay. So in the data link layer is also known as the layer hop-to-hop delivery. Data link layer is responsible for hop-to-hop delivery. Hop, H-O-P, hop-to-hop delivery. Okay. As I've already mentioned, a hop is nothing but an intermediary device. Okay. Sometimes this hop is also known as node. So all these are synonymous terms being used in the networking, you know, area. So a hop is intermediary device. It may be a laptop, it may be a phone, it may be a tower. Okay, it may be any networking device we'll discuss later stage. That is, it may be a switch, it may be a router, it may be a router, it may be a gateway. So it is any intermediary device. Okay, it may be your mobile phone as well. So we have different types of network. So your mobile phone may be a hop. Let's take how your mobile phone can be a hop. That is, for example, you are sharing your data with your friend. For example, you have recharged for your data connection, but your friend or one of your family member has no recharge for data. So you can provide your hotspot to share the data with your friend. So your data connection can be shared with your friend or your family member. So in that case, when your friend is connecting with the internet, basically all information are passing through your mobile phone to the internet. So in that case, your mobile phone is a hop to your friend mobile phone, because he or she is using your mobile data. So whatever information he is trying to access from the internet, so all these information should pass from your mobile phone to the internet. So in that case, your device is acting as a intermediary device or hop for your friend mobile phone. So this is a very general example that we are really day-to-day life we are facing. Okay, so data link layer is responsible for hop-to-hop delivery. Okay, so let me again clarify you that. Let's take my laptop is connected with the internet, and I am using, for example, BSNL mobile for my data connection. So when I am trying to access to the internet, my laptop should first connect to the nearest tower of the BSNL. So now data link layer is conform all the specifications and functionalities which are required to communicate my laptop with my nearest tower. Okay, so don't confuse that key data link layer is responsible for communication between source to destination. No. Suppose I want to download a movie or song from YouTube server, then my laptop is the source and the destination is the YouTube server. But data link layer is not like that. Data link layer is conforming to the communication between my laptop and the nearest tower. Okay, so what are the functionality given by this data link layer? Let us discuss one by one. The first functionality, is the physical addressing. That is 48-bit physical addressing. Okay, so whenever a NIC card is installed or programmed in the motherboard of our system, then the NIC card comes with a physical address. And that is called the permanent address of a system. It is of 48 bit. Basically, the physical address is 6 byte information where it is of alphanumeric form. Okay, I will show you in slide in later case how a physical address looks like. Okay, so if you want to see the physical address of your laptop, you can just open the backside of your laptop and just go to the motherboard. Inside the motherboard, you will find the NIC card installed there. And in front, on the top of the NIC card, you will see a 48-bit physical address. So what should it look like? It just 6 positions separated by 5 column. Okay, so its structure is 6 position. For example, 00 column, 01 column, then some alphanumeric character should be there. 0A, capital A column, then 1B, that is capital B column, 06, something like that. So 6 positions are there, and each position carries two bytes of information. So it is of total 48 bit. Okay, so 48-bit physical address is given to all the network devices. So this physical address must be there inside your mobile phone. That is called IMEI number. Okay, then inside your laptop, that is in the motherboard on the top of the NIC card, you will have the physical address for your system. Okay, then if you look at any networking device like switch or router, they must have a physical address because it is the permanent address of your device. So any network host or any network node or system, must possess a physical address, which is the permanent address of that system. Okay, so these physical address are the part of the data link layer. So data link layer provides the permanent address to every node or every networking device. Okay, and it is of 48 bit. It is very important to remember that every networking device has a 48 bit physical address, and it is given by the data link layer. Okay, so as I mentioned that NIC card, that is called the network interface card. Okay, so network interface card is actually, I can say it is a firmware. Okay, firmware means it is neither a hardware nor a software. Okay, so basically these firmwares are part of the design of motherboards. I'm just giving a little bit electronics part. That is, when we want to install some software, we have to use some firmwares. These firmwares actually make a tie-up between the internal hardwares and the softwares which are installed in our computer. So we only access to the computer, or we use our computer because we have an operating system installed in the computer. Unless we have an operating system in the computer, we cannot use our computer. And operating system, how our operating system is using the computer hardwares. Because inside our computer, we have a CPU, central processing unit, and some memory registers. Okay, memory are where we are storing the data. A memory are of again two type, primary memory and the secondary memory. Primary memory is called the RAM, that is called random access memory, and the secondary memory is our hard disk. Okay, so this is a basic idea about a computer system. A computer essentially is a electromechanical device where we have a very the brain of the computer is a CPU, central processing unit, and we have some memory devices. Okay, and the memory device and CPU are really connected so that whenever we try to execute any instruction, then it first comes to the RAM. From RAM, it comes to the CPU. That's why we really want the size of the RAM should be big, because whatever instruction we want to execute, it must first load to the RAM, then from RAM to the CPU. And our secondary memory is not directly connected to the CPU, and secondary memory is slowest memory than the primary memory, that is called our RAM. So whenever you want to execute any instruction, we must first put it inside the RAM, and RAM eventually send it to the CPU, and CPU eventually execute the instruction, and it finds it shows the result of anything. So how our operating system, the thing is that how our operating system make use of such hardware. The CPU is a hardware device. It is consists of only the semiconductor cells, or it uses some silicon chips like that. So it is completely a hardware stuff. So how our whatever we are writing in our top English high level language, how the programs are being executed. So our operating system is responsible for that. Okay, so our operating system somehow is able to communicate with the underlying hardwares. And who are making this thing possible? There are some drivers. So whenever you want to use any softwares on any applications related to our hardware, it must have a driver. And driver are nothing but the firmwares. That is the intermediate or in between hardware and the software. Hardware are the physical or the touchable part of a system. Softwares are the programs or the instructions. Okay, so in between, how this hardware would communicate with the software, that is called firmware. Okay, so firmware are the drivers. And these drivers are really programmed in the embedded system programming. So this is a part of the electronics part. So NIC is one firmware, okay, which is really programmed by using embedded system programming, where the firmware have been or the device drivers are being used, and this NIC card is imprinted in on the top of the motherboard. And all the NIC card is dealing with another thing that is called network operating system, that is NOS. Okay, so our Windows must contain a NOS, that is network operating system, which enables our Windows system to connect with the internet or connect with the network. So it is the NIC card which gives us an interface to communicate with the network, or to enable our system to be communicate with the network. Okay, and this NIC card also provides the physical addressing to our system. And this physical addressing is the 48-bit physical addressing, which is the permanent address of our system. Okay, this is one functionality of the data link layer. Second functionality is the framing. Okay, framing means what? When a stream of information is collected from the upper layers, then this stream of information is divided into small frames. Okay, for example, let's take we have a stream of information of 1,000 bytes. Okay, so 1,000 bytes should be divided into small frames, each of size 100 bytes. So we have 10 such frames of 100 bytes. So this is called a framing. Okay, for the time being, framing means only divide up the large amount of information into small size of frames. That is called framing. Okay, why we need such a framing? We need to see in the third functionality of the data link layer. That is, the third functionality is the flow control. Okay, flow control means how to control the data rate. And where, how, why we need to control the data rate? For example, if we have a faster sender and a slow receiver, faster sender means the sending of information is quite fast, but the receiver cannot consume that information as fast as the sender is sending the information. I can say the data rate of the sender is much higher than the data rate of the receiver. In that case, we must have some mechanism to control the flow of data. Because if you continue keep on sending the data, but the receiver is not able to consume the data, then there's a chance of data loss. There's no need, or there is not at all meaning of sending data, but the receiver is just dropping the data because unable to consume the data in that speed. So whatever thing he can consume only can process and store the data, and whatever thing he cannot consume, he can only drop the data. So it is a chance of the data loss. So in order to minimize the data loss, we must impose some data flow mechanisms. We will study that. There are a lot of flow control mechanisms, that is stop and wait protocol. Then we have selective repeat protocol, automatic repeat request protocol. Okay, so these are some protocols where we can control the data flow or data flow rate in order to minimize the data loss. So flow control essentially means if we have a faster sender and a slow receiver, then the data rate, the rate at which the sender is sending the data must be controlled in some mechanism so that the receiver will consume at the rate what it actually consumes the things. Okay, for example, the sender is sending 10 bits per second and the receiver is consuming only 5 bits per second. So if you are sending 10 bits, he is consuming only 5 bits, the rest 5 bits are lost. Again, you need to retransmit the things at that case. Okay, so why not you send 5 bits per second if the receiver is consuming 5 bits only? You send 5 bits, then wait for an acknowledgement, then send again the next 5 bits. That's why we also do the framing. Okay, so if I have a 10 bits of data I have received from my upper layer, then I have to divide these 10 bits of data into two frames of 5 bits so that I can send 5 bits, again wait for the acknowledgement from the receiver, then I can send the next 5 bits. Okay, so we do the framing. And for the data control, flow control mechanism, we send the rate at which the receiver consume. We don't send the rate at which we can send. Okay, next mechanism is your access control. Okay, access control mechanism ensures that if there is a multi-point link or a link which is shared by multiple devices, now at any given time, which device has control over the link? If at the same time all are sending the things, then there's a huge chance of collisions of the data. In order to minimize the collision of the data, we must have some mechanism to ensure that who is controlling over the link at any given time. Okay, actually, if you look at practical scenario, we are really sharing same router or same tower. We are a number of subscribers of a same provider, but at the same time, how we are again communicating with the same same time. That is really a question that may be coming to your mind, that if we are using the same tower, if we are in the radius of the same tower, how we are able to talk with each other, or how we are able to use our mobile data, we are able to use our mobile phone at the same time. Okay, we will see, for to answer this question, we will see many protocols for the access control mechanism. There are some time shared protocol that is called time division multiple access. We'll see code division multiple access. Okay, so there are a lot of protocols involved where you will see that the links are divided in a time frame. We are actually getting the links in a time frame manner or in a round robin manner, but the switching of this time is so fast, it is in nanoseconds. We are not able to differentiate that whether I am only using the link or all are using the link at the same time. Okay, so there are a lot of multiple access mechanism we'll study in the later classes. One is frequency division multiple access, one is time division multiple access, one is code division multiple access. In the frequency division multiple access, one channel is divided by using the frequency. I have not yet teach you about the frequency, that's why you can understand, but I'm giving you a very simple example where you can visualize what I'm trying to tell. In your TV, or let us take an example of FM radio. Okay, FM radio, okay, you'll get in Sambalpur, we are getting only one channel, but if you'll go to Bhubaneswar, you will get many channels. Okay, suppose you are all our mobile phones are now FM radio capable. Okay, so what we are doing actually, all the channels are coming to our mobile phone, which are present in the city. Only we are changing the tuners. There is a frequency given to all channels. So we are only changing the frequency, and according to the frequency, we are getting the channels. So this is called the frequency division multiple access, means multiple channels are using the same link. Okay, but they are using the same link by different frequencies. So here the link is shared by multiple channels, but each channel is given a separate frequency. So that is the simple example of frequency division multiple access. Okay, if you are not confirm or convinced on this FM radio example, let's take your television example. Okay, suppose you are having a cable TV connection, your television is having one cable connection, okay, where you are finding all the channels. You do not have multiple connection for each channel, that's for sure. You are having one connection, that is one cable TV connection, or if you have installed Tata Sky or Airtel Digital TV, whatever. So you have only one connection, only one cable is there, but you are getting multiple channels. So this is how one channel, you are having one cable. So how the bandwidth of the cable is divided, or how the bandwidth of the cable is shared among multiple channels. Again, the frequency come into the picture. The bandwidth of the channel is divided or is shared between multiple channels by different frequency range. So when your remote changes to different channels, it actually changes the frequencies. So by different frequency, by changing or by providing different frequencies to different channels, we are able to connect to multiple channels in a single cable. Okay, so we will study about different access control mechanisms like frequency, time division multiple access, and code division multiple access to understand how a shared medium or a multipoint connection is shared among multiple devices and how they are actually communicating at the same time without having, minimum collisions. Sometimes when we are talking in phone, we cannot say that collision doesn't happen. Yes, collision happens. That's why we face call drops. We face some error in network connection. Okay, these are the collisions. Basically, when you face error in network connection, means there may be a collision between your call and somebody else who is actually calling at the same time. Eventually, there something happens and your signal is collided with your with the other subscriber, you know, signal. That's why you have faced the error in network connection. Or sometimes your you know, you're facing, there is a call drop. These are the very simple or practical examples that we are facing nowadays. Okay, so this is how the access control is all about. So this is access control is also a part of the physical, your data link layer functionalities. Then important thing is error control, which is very important. Means the sender, your receiver device must ensure that I have got the accurate information that is being sent by the sender. Okay, for example, you have sent hi and the receiver will receive bye. So how receiver will confirm that actually you have sent bye? That is the part of the error control mechanisms. Otherwise, the two parties will again collide with each other or conflict. There must be a conflict between two parties because you have sent hi, but it is due to the problem of network. It is eventually reached at the form of bye. And the receiver is complaining that why you have sent me bye? And you told that no, I have sent you a hi. It was eventually rich. I don't know how it is converted to buy. So network must confirm that key actually that is an error, you know, in the communication. That's why it eventually reaches in the form of buy. Okay, so your networking device, the data link layer of your device must ensure that the data should be reached at the correct form. So we have different error control mechanisms. Before you are visualizing the data, your, you know, the data link layer of your device ensure that data should be corrected. And he must show you the correct data. If the data is incorrect, it will not show you the data unless it finds or unless it gets a corrected data. It is actually in the background, it is happening. We don't know. In the background, all the things are happening, but as a you know, consumer of the internet service, we don't know about all these things. But the data link layer, that is the NIC card and the interfaces, are doing such things. They are programmed like that. So in error control, you will see many mechanisms and many protocols. Like if the interface will, you know, receive erroneous data, then it will send the or it will tell the sender that you retransmit the data. So sometimes you might have seen that you will get the you'll receive the message in late, even though you have the internet connection, because somehow at some point the data coming from some point may be erroneous, and your interface is telling that sender that you resend the data. That's why for this process, you may get, you may receive the data in delay. You may, the receiving of the data may be delayed for that reason. Okay, so this is part of the error control mechanism, and your interface are being programmed like that. They must ensure that the receiver will receive the error-free data. Okay, there are many mechanisms we have. Some checksum mechanism for how we can define that whether we have got the same information or not. There is a checksum mechanism. There is a cyclic redundancy check that is called CRC check. So CRC check is most popular in LAN technology. CRC 32. Okay, if you have worked in networking, some of you, if you have worked earlier or if you have studied earlier networking subject, you will find that CRC 32 is a common, you know, error control mechanism which are being used mostly in our LAN technologies. Okay, so that is called the error. Okay, error may happens because our signal travels across the medium, that is basically air medium. So error may happen due to noise. Okay, due to the attenuation. Okay, attenuation means when your message is transmitted across a link, then the message I have already told it is transmitted in the form of signals. So basically signals dissipate some energy because signal carries some voltage. Okay, signal carries your data in terms of voltage. So when it come across or when it travels or flow across the medium, it dissipates some energy in order to overcome the resistance of the medium. Okay, so in that case also, when it dissipates some energy, okay, when it discharges some energy, then in that case also your data shape or the signal shape may change, and if the signal shape may change, your data may be also corrupted, or data may, there is a chance of data a loss or corruption of the data. So in that case also you may get erroneous data. So noise may be a factor, attenuation may be a factor, distortion may be a factor, because if the signals may reach at different shape, different signal components may reach at different shape to the destination, then it is called a distortion. We'll discuss while we'll study signal system, that how the signals actually, what is the shape of the signal, and how the signal shape can be changed. Okay, so there are many factors in which or many factors associated with how the data or information can be erroneous one. Okay, so whenever there is an error, so your interface have already programmed to detect the error and to correct the error. So error detection and error correction mechanisms are already installed while the interface was designed for your laptop or for your phone. So in the background, the actually the if you are getting or if you are receiving erroneous data, it is in the background corrected, and while you are visualizing the data, where you are seeing, watching the data or receiving the data in through your interface, that is through your mobile phone or through your laptop, you are getting the corrected data. So networking, your data link layer of the OSI model ensures about the error, error-free data to the next hop. Okay. So the functionality we have discussed, that first is 48-bit physical addressing. Second one is your flow control, then framing, then access control, then error control. So all these mechanisms are the part of the data link layer, and the implementation of the data link layer is nothing but your all the interfaces that is inside our motherboard or inside our laptop. All the RJ45 interface is the implementation of the data link layer. The NIC card is the implementation of the data link layer. So the vendors of NIC card and the interface must conform or must ensure the functionality that we have discussed. These interfaces are must ensure the your physical addressing, error control, flow control, and framing. Okay. Now next come to the third layer, that is our network layer, which is responsible for source to destination delivery. Okay, so here basically source to destination means source network to the destination network. Okay, suppose my system is connected to this BSNL network of University Burla, and my destination network, for example, I'm trying to connect with the OSIU network, and it is in the Sambalpur. So network layer is responsible for the communication of the information from UC Burla, that is BSS UT Burla network, to the Sambalpur OSIU network. Okay, so this is network layer is responsible for that kind of source to destination delivery. The functionality includes IP addressing, that is called 32-bit logical addressing system, or internet protocol V4, IPv4 addressing. You all have, I think, conversant with the IP address. Okay, whenever a system is connected to the internet or network, it must have a logical address called the IP address, so that a system can be uniquely identified in a network. Okay, in the data link layer, we have seen that every system, whenever a network system is manufactured, it must have a permanent address, that is called the physical address. Are you getting? But in the networking, whenever a system is connected to a network, okay, so try to understand the difference between these two addresses. The physical address, whenever a network device is manufactured, at that time, the address given is the permanent address. It is called the physical address. It is of the 48-bit, okay, which is the part of the data link layer. But whenever a device is connected to a network or internet, it is given a logical address, that is called 32-bit logical address, or called the IP address.
Okay, this IP address is called the logical address to uniquely identify a device connected in a network. It is a 32-bit which is separated by four dots. For an example, the IP address is in the form, you can note it down, 192.168.10.1. It is an example of IP address. I will elaborately take a class on IP addressing system, because it is very, very important for a network engineer to understand the IP address. Whenever you are going to design a network manually, you must need to understand how you can assign IP addresses to a 50 or 100 system given to you. Okay, nowadays we have some softwares available so that we can, if we install a software in a server, it automatically provides IP addresses. These softwares are essentially called DHCP softwares, Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol softwares, which automatically then dynamically assign IP addresses. But as a network administrator, you must know how to assign IP addresses manually. Because while you are dealing with, or while you will debug a problem, you must need what is exactly the IP address given to a system. When dynamically IP addresses are assigned to a system, it is very, very what, cumbersome to know what exactly the IP address of a particular system. But if you manually assign the IP address to a system, you will know that this is the IP address of that system. I will study one class, one lecture. I'll devote one lecture on IP addressing and subnetting, how you can create network, how you can assign the IP addresses. We'll discuss on that. But assigning IP address is the part of this network layer. Okay. So network layer again works for the routing of the message. Already in the postal system, I have given you example that if we put our letter inside a mail vein, to move the letter to the destination. Now, if we have multiple routes or multiple paths from source to destination, which path the vein must choose? Okay, that must be a shortest path. Okay, so choosing of this path is the part of the functionality of network layer. Okay, that's why it is called, otherwise in the networking language, it is known as routing. Okay, routing means selecting of the shortest route for transmission of the message. So routing, the functionality to identify the shortest route, is the part of the network layer. Okay, network layer is also responsible for congestion control. Means in a path, if the data traffic is quite heavy or quite more, then how to control that congestion, or how to control that rush? In a rough language, we can say rush. Okay, jab road mein traffic jam ho jata hai to hum usko rush bolte hain. To waise hi jab network mein jyada traffic, data traffic badh jata hai, usko hum congestion bolte hain. Okay, for example, metro cities ke bare mein aap dekho, jahan pe population ka density bahut kuch jyada hai, वहां पे क्या होता है कि सब्सक्राइबर्स बहुत होते हैं, कंपनीज काफी होते हैं, ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस बहुत होते हैं जो कि इंटरनेट को यूज करते हैं, नेटवर्क को यूज करते हैं. उस केस में होता है क्या है कि आपका एक पर्टिकुलर एरिया में डेटा ट्रैफिक बढ़ जाता है, बिकॉज फ्रीक्वेंटली दे आर यूजिंग द इंटरनेट एंड फ्रीक्वेंटली दे आर यूजिंग द यू नो नेटवर्क सर्विसेज. दैट्स व्हाई द डेटा ट्रैफिक गोज यू नो इन इन अ हैवी वे. So if data traffic goes heavy way, then क्या होगा, तो आपका जो लिंक का कैपेसिटी से जब वो बाहर हो जाएगा, तब वो लिंक क्रैश हो सकता है, और वो जो लिंक है वो बंद हो सकता है और वो काम नहीं कर सकता है. तो इन ऑर्डर टू ओवरकम इन दैट कंडीशन, वी मस्ट हैव सम कंजेशन कंट्रोल मैकेनिज्म्स. ओके, कि जिस लिंक की कैपेसिटी जितनी है, ओके, उस लिंक में उतना ही डेटा जाना चाहिए. जैसे वो बात हो गया कि अगर इफ यू हैव अ शॉर्टेस्ट पाथ, अगर सब कोई शॉर्टेस्ट पाथ ले जाएंगे तो उसमें ट्रैफिक ज्यादा हो जाएगा. सो कभी कभी राउटर्स क्या करते हैं कि वो देखते हैं कि उनके राउटिंग टेबल है, हम डिस्कशन करेंगे, राउटिंग टेबल के हिसाब से वो देखते हैं कि कितनी मेरे पास रिक्वेस्ट आया है, कौन कौन सा सोर्स से मेरे पास डाटा आया है, फिर वो राउटिंग टेबल चेक करते हैं और देखते हैं कि कौन कौन सा लिंक का क्या क्या अभी तक कैपेसिटी है, कितना वो डेटा भी ले रहा है. तो अकॉर्डिंगली वो एक क्या करते हैं, लिंक्स पे भी लोड को बैलेंस करते हैं। ये लोड बैलेंसिंग मैकेनिज्म है जिसमें बहुत रिसर्च चल रहा है, लोड ऑफ पीएचडी थेसिस आर बीइंग डन इन दिस लोड बैलेंसिंग थिंग्स। ओके, सो कंडीशन कंट्रोल इज नथिंग बट द लोड बैलेंसिंग, बैलेंसिंग ऑफ द लोड्स और द डेटा रेट एट डिफरेंट लिंक्स कनेक्टेड टू अ राउटर। ओके, सो दिस इज अ पार्ट ऑफ द कंजेशन कंट्रोल। वी विल डिस्कस इफ टाइम परमिट्स मेनी मैकेनिज्म्स ऑफ द कंजेशन कंट्रोल। ओके, सो दिस कंजेशन कंट्रोल आर ऑल्सो पार्ट ऑफ दिस नेटवर्क लेयर। सो नेटवर्क लेयर इज रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर थ्री इंपॉर्टेंट फंक्शनैलिटीज, दैट इज योर आईपी एड्रेसिंग, देन योर राउटिंग, देन योर कंजेशन कंट्रोल। नाउ टेक्स्ट गो टू द योर ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर। ओके, सो नेटवर्क लेयर इज कॉल्ड सोर्स टू डेस्टिनेशन लेयर बिकॉज इट कंफर्म दैट फ्रॉम सोर्स नेटवर्क द इंफॉर्मेशन मस्ट बी डिलीवर्ड फ्रॉम द सोर्स नेटवर्क टू द डेस्टिनेशन नेटवर्क। ओके, नॉट सिस्टम, बेसिकली इट इज कॉल्ड सोर्स टू डेस्टिनेशन। ओके, सो नाउ कम टू द ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर। या नाउ ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर इज कॉल्ड प्रोसेस टू प्रोसेस डिलीवरी। इट इज रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर प्रोसेस टू प्रोसेस, इट इज द टेक्निकल लैंग्वेज कॉल्ड प्रोसेस टू प्रोसेस। आई कैन से इन योर लैंग्वेज दैट इज एप्लीकेशन टू एप्लीकेशन, एप्स टू एप्स। लेट्स से apps to apps means what? For example, you are using internet and you are at the same time you open four tabs in your laptop. For example, in one tab you open your Gmail account, in another tab you are opening this online counseling session, and another tab you are doing Facebook. So three tabs you are doing. Now for example, a message is coming from Facebook. If you are very interested in Facebook, then you will open that Facebook message. Okay, now the problem happens when now your machine is now sending data or receiving data. Now data is coming to your machine by the IP address. Your machine has given an IP address because it is connected to the internet. A 32-bit IP address is given. You can check your IP address. You can simply, if you type what is my ip.com in website, you'll find the IP address of your system. Now very simple, I will also provide some command prompt tricks where you can look at your IP address. But in simply, if you can write that what is my ip.com, you'll find the IP address of your system. So in the network layer, IP address is given to your system. Now data is rich to your system, but the problem is that you have four different applications opened in your system. Now which application is requesting the data? So that from your system, the data is rich to that particular application. Because you have opened four applications in one Gmail, one is Google Meet, one is your Facebook, one is some YouTube. Four applications are opened. So definitely we'll give address to all these applications to the particular application requesting the information from the server. Okay, so the address given to the application are called the port address. Okay, or sometimes it is called the process address. And transport layer is responsible for providing port address or the process address. And this port address is of 16-bit. For example, the ports may be 80, maybe 443, maybe 53. 80 port is given to HTTP. HTTP is a protocol we will discuss. So all the HTTP protocol related applications are assigned a port number called 80. 443 is a port number for the HTTPS. We will study what is HTTPS. You might have seen in the URL or the address bar of your browser, some sites begin with HTTP, some sites begin with HTTPS. So all these are given some port number called 80 for HTTP and 443 for HTTPS. There is another protocol we'll study later stage that is called DNS. DNS is having a port number 53. Okay, so port number essentially is the address of applications, whatever apps. For example, you are using WhatsApp. In the WhatsApp also it is assigned a port number. Okay, we will study that. If you are more interested to know about ports, you will study there are three different category of port number, and we will have 65,535 port numbers available. Are you getting 65,535 port numbers available? And it is categorized into three category. One is well-known ports, registered ports, and dynamic ports. Well-known ports are the ports given to the some well-known protocols like HTTP, HTTPS, DNS, FTP, Telnet. All these protocols are assigned a known port number, and it ranges up to 021023. 0 से लेके 1023 तक जो ports है उनको हम बोलते हैं well-known ports. And basically, these ports are given to well-known applications like HTTP, HTTPS, DNS, FTP, Telnet, all these applications. And 1024 से लेके 49,151 तक जो port है, हम उसको बोलते हैं registered port. Okay, so registered ports are given to some specific applications. बाकी जो 49,152 से लेके 65,535 पोर्ट्स को डायनेमिक पोर्ट बोलते हैं. इनको हम किसी भी एप्लीकेशंस को डायनेमिकली हमारा जो ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर है वो असाइन कर लेता है. कोई भी एप्लीकेशंस, जो भी नया एप्लीकेशंस आता है, जो भी नया एप्स आता है, जो भी नया वेबसाइट्स आता है, जितने भी कमर्शियल वेबसाइट्स हैं, इनकी पोर्ट नंबर आप मार्क करना 49,152 से लेके 65,535 के अंदर में रहता है. सो ये पोर्ट एड्रेसिंग जो है इट्स अ पार्ट ऑफ योर ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर फंक्शनलिटी. ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर रिस्पॉन्सिबल है एरर कंट्रोल के लिए एंड फ्लो कंट्रोल के लिए. बट यहाँ पे एरर एंड फ्लो कंट्रोल होता है प्रोसेस टू प्रोसेस. जैसे डेटा लिंक लेयर में हमने एरर एंड फ्लो कंट्रोल देखा था, जहाँ पे एरर एंड फ्लो कंट्रोल हॉप टू हॉप होता है, मीन्स फ्रॉम योर डिवाइस टू योर नियरेस्ट राउटर, जो नियरेस्ट जो हॉप है उसके बीच में, वैसे हर हॉप जो इंटरमीडिएट हॉप है उनके बीच में भी फ्लो कंट्रोल मैकेनिज्म्स होता है. और दिस इज द पार्ट ऑफ द डेटा लिंक लेयर. बट आपका ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर में जो फ्लो कंट्रोल होता है वो प्रोसेस टू प्रोसेस होता है, एंड टू एंड फ्लो कंट्रोल भी उसको बोलते हैं. ओके, देन ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर में और एक फंक्शनलिटी है जो कि आपका रीअसेंबली एंड आपका डिवाइड ऑफ द मैसेज इनटू मल्टीपल यू नो डेटाग्राम वो करता है, डिफरेंट पैकेट्स में वो डिवाइड करता है मैसेज को. अपर लेयर में अगर मैसेज आया, बड़ा सा मैसेज है, तो उसको फिर से जैसे हम डाटा लिंक लेयर में फ्रेमिंग किए थे, यहाँ पे हम उसको सेगमेंटेशन करेंगे. उसको हम सेगमेंटेशन एंड रीअसेंबली करते हैं. बड़ा मैसेज को छोटा छोटा सेगमेंट में डिवाइड करते हैं, बिकॉज यहाँ पे भी वी आर डीलिंग विद द फ्लो कंट्रोल एंड इट इज प्रोसेस टू प्रोसेस फ्लो कंट्रोल. सो यू डू द सेगमेंटेशन इन ऑर्डर टू कंट्रोल द फ्लो ऑफ डेटा बिटवीन टू प्रोसेस. एंड रिसीवर साइड में वो क्या करता है, और जब हम इसको सेगमेंटेशन करते हैं, हम ईच सेगमेंट का एक सिक्वेंस नंबर देते हैं. और जैसे रिसीवर एंड में वो सेगमेंट्स गैदरिंग होते हैं, सिक्वेंस नंबर के हिसाब से हम उसको रीअसेंबल करते हैं. तो सेगमेंटेशन एंड रीअसेंबली आर ऑल्सो द पार्ट ऑफ फंक्शनलिटी ऑफ द योर ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर. गेटिंग ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर इज ऑल्सो रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर कनेक्शन ओरिएंटेड एंड कनेक्शन लेस सर्विसेस. कनेक्शन ओरिएंटेड सर्विस क्या है? बिफोर मेकिंग ए कम्युनिकेशन विथ अ डिवाइस, फर्स्ट वी नीड टू एस्टेब्लिश अ कनेक्शन. इफ यू वॉन्ट टू एस्टेब्लिश अ कनेक्शन, देन इट इज कॉल्ड कनेक्शन ओरिएंटेड. If without establishing a connection, we just send the message, then it is called connectionless. जैसे कि अगर आप आपकी दोस्त के घर जाना चाहते हैं छुट्टियों बिताने के लिए, if you make a call to your friend before reaching to his home, then it is called connection oriented. If you reach to your friend by just for giving him a surprise, जैसे सरप्राइज विजिट करने के लिए आप पहुंच गए विदाउट मेकिंग अ कॉल, यू जस्ट रीच टू योर फ्रेंड हाउस फॉर जस्ट टू सरप्राइज हिम, इट इज कॉल्ड कनेक्शन लेस. सो कनेक्शन ओरिएंटेड में क्या होता है कि डाटा डिलीवरी हमेशा एक्यूरेट होता है, बिकॉज बिफोर डिलीवरिंग द डेटा यू हैव एस्टेब्लिश्ड अ कनेक्शन. सो यू नो योर डिवाइस मस्ट नो दैट वेदर द रिसीवर इज रेडी टू रिसीव द डेटा और नॉट, और वेदर ही इज प्रेजेंट टू रिसीव द डेटा और नॉट. सो इन दैट केस इन द कनेक्शन ओरिएंटेड सर्विसेज डेटा लॉस कम होता है, और ज़्यादातर होता ही नहीं है. बट ये टाइम कंज्यूमिंग ज़्यादा है, बिकॉज फॉर मेकिंग ए कनेक्शन इट टेक सम टाइम. बट कनेक्शन लेस जो होता है ये टाइम कम लेता है, बिकॉज यू डोंट नीड कनेक्शन फॉर सेंडिंग योर डेटा. बट देर इज अ चांस ऑफ डेटा लॉस. Why? If receiver is not ready to receive the data, or receiver is not present, in that case your data get lost or get data may be dropped. So this connection oriented and connectionless services are also part of this transport layer functionalities. So we have seen that transport layer functionalities, that it conform the port addressing, 16-bit port addressing. It is a single, it is just a digit. It is not separated by column. As I have mentioned, 80 is the port address of HTTP 443. Okay. In the physical address, we have 6-byte information, 48-bit, separated by, you know, 6 positions separated by a column. That is called your physical addressing. In the logical addressing, 4-bit, 32-bit means 4 positions separated by a dot, like 192.168.1.10.1. Okay, but in case of port addressing, we don't need that column or dot. We only a single, number. We just a number. It's a number. It is either 80 or 443 or 53, like that. Okay, then it also with this transport layer also ensure flow control and error control, and this flow and error control are process to process, not hop to hop, unlike your data link layer. The process to process flow control and process to process error control, or transport layer also conform the segmentation and reassembly. It divide the large packet into small segments. And again at the receivers, and it provides sequence number to each segment so that it all the segments can be reassembled in the sequence to form the actual message. Okay, so again the transport layer conform about the connection oriented and connectionless services. Yes, now come to the your session layer. Session layer is responsible for creation and maintaining of the session. What is a session? I'm just giving just to know you the basic thing of session. You have a log, you might have a online SBI account. Some of you may be using online SBI account. Okay, so in online SBI account, when you log in to the account for fund transfer or for doing any monetary transactions, okay, if you for once for 10 seconds or 20 seconds, if you make the things ideal, if you don't do the things, only log into and you are searching and surfing something, after 20 seconds you will see that your session has expired. Your session has expired. This is an example. Another example, if you are a customer of IRCTC site, means if you are logging IRCTC for booking train tickets, you might have also seen or experienced the same, you know, things. If you are ideal, if you're not doing anything in the IRCTC site, then it will send you a message that your session has expired. These are the practical things that you have already faced. Okay, so we can come to the definition of what is session. So session layer must ensure that when two applications are communicating with each other, they must establish a session. Okay, so creation, maintaining of the session is the part of the session layer. Okay, as a network security personnel, you will see in the later stage that how these session informations are really used by hackers to hack different accounts and to hack or to see what are your browsing history, to see what you are doing in the session. Okay, so your session history will be captured by using different softwares by the hackers. Okay, now session layer is also helps in maintaining checkpoints. So maintaining checkpoints is the functionality of the session layer. Maintaining checkpoints means what? Again, I am giving you an example where you can understand what does it mean. Suppose you are downloading a movie from YouTube. Okay, so when you are downloading a movie from YouTube, you might have seen that the downloading process is divided into 7 or 8 steps, and each step is downloading a bit of information. It means what? When the session layer first, when it downloads data or information from any server, it puts some checkpoints. Okay, for example, you are downloading 100 MB of data, then session layer put checkpoints in every 10 MB of data. So 10 checkpoints are there. So when you start downloading the data, at the checkpoint is used for recovering the data while failure occurs when you are downloading the things. For example, when you are downloading the things and you have downloaded up to 40 MB of data, but your network fails or your power fails or your data connection interrupted. So if the session layer doesn't maintain the checkpoints, what happens? Again, when you connect to the internet, your data your downloading of the data starts from the beginning. Okay, but if you have maintained the checkpoints, it will start downloading from the last checkpoint. Means, suppose your data happens at 42 MB and your session layer maintained checkpoints at 40 MB, so you only lost 2 MB of data and your downloading will resume from the 40 MB of the data. Okay, if there is no checkpoint rule, then your downloading begins from the your downloading again it from the beginning. You download your data. Are you getting it? अगर checkpoint नहीं होता तो आप पहले से फिर से download करना शुरू करोगे, लेकिन अगर checkpoint है और बीच में कोई फेलियर हो गया है तो आपको पहले से डाउनलोड नहीं करना पड़ेगा. आपका सिस्टम क्या होगा, जहां जो चेक पॉइंट नियरेस्ट चेक पॉइंट जो आपका है वहां से डाउनलोड शुरू करेगा. तो 42 MB डाउनलोड किए हो और आपका डाटा इंटरनेट फेल हो गया है तो वो क्या करेगा, 40 MB तक चेक पॉइंट बनाया है तो 40 MB से फिर डाटा डाउनलोड करना शुरू करेगा. तो इस केस में आप ओनली 2 MB का लॉस हुआ, बाकी आपका 40 MB जो डाउनलोड किए हुए हैं वो बच गया है और आपका रिज्यूम हो गया है. तो आपका डाउनलोडिंग में जो भी ऑप्शंस आता है कि कैंसिल करो, रिज्यूम करो, स्टॉप करो, ऑल दीज ऑप्शंस आर ड्यू टू दिस सेशन लेयर फंक्शनलिटीज. ओके, नाउ कम टू योर आवर प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर, दैट इज अ सिक्स्थ लेयर. प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर इज रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर ट्रांसलेशन. ट्रांसलेशन क्या होता है कि हमारा नेटवर्क में डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ मशीन्स हम यूज करते हैं. डिफरेंट टाइप का मशीन का क्या होता है, अंडरलाइंग जो हार्डवेयर आर्किटेक्चर है वो डिफरेंट है. अगर हार्डवेयर आर्किटेक्चर हमारा डिफरेंट रहेगा तो उस केस में क्या होता है, हम जब बिट्स का एनकोडिंग करते हैं, व्हेन वी कन्वर्ट द हाई लेवल डेटा टू द बिट्स, दैट वी कॉल्ड कोडिंग. तो कोडिंग जब करते हैं कि इनकी कोडिंग की फॉर्मेट अलग अलग होती है. If the format of coding is different, so in that case क्या होगा, different device फिर वही होगा कि they cannot understand the coding of each other. So in order to solve that problem, what presentation layer offers to you that the coding that is given by the hardware is eventually translated to a uniform or a common format. Now this common format is being transmitted, encoded in the signal, and the signal is traveled, and at the receiver side, the common format is decoded to the machine understandable format, and the machine now convert the machine understandable format to the bit format. So I guess you understand what is the translation about. Means conversion of the sender format to a common format, then common format at the receiver side, the common format is converted to the again receiver understandable format, and the receiver will consume the data. This is called the translation. So presentation layer is responsible for this translation, and it is also responsible for encryption of the data. You might have studied now studying about the information security course, where you have encountered this term encryption. Encryption is nothing but the code word of the data for the security. To enhance the security, we must give a code word of whatever data we are sending. For example, we are sending the message hi, but if we encrypt the message by a code, let us say hi is coded by 62, h for 6, I for 2. So 62 is sending across the medium. It is a coded one. So if a third party will access this in the network, he cannot confirm, or he cannot assume that what is actually the communication about, what is actually the information about, because he will get the coded information. That is, you have coded it to 62. The actual information you have, you coded it to 62. So any third party can only get 62, not the exact information. That's why we go for encryption. So we are encrypting the data in order to avoid it being accessed by the third party while the data is in the network. And even though a third party access to the network, you know, data, he cannot get the exact data or information that is being transmitted. That's why you go for the encryption. So encryption is done or implemented in the presentation layer of the OSI model. You might, if you are using Gmail account, you'll find that your data is encrypted. जब भी आप जीमेल में कोई भी इंफॉर्मेशन और मेल सेंड करते हो वो क्या होता है, वो एनक्रिप्टेड फॉर्मेट में जाता है. ओके, सो दिस इज द पार्ट ऑफ द प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर. उसके बाद आपका नेक्स्ट लेयर है योर एप्लीकेशन लेयर, विच इज द सेवेंथ एंड द लास्ट लेयर. एप्लीकेशन लेयर का काम है कि वो इंटरफेस, इट प्रोवाइड्स इंटरफेस टू द यूजर्स. ओके, सो दैट यू कैन यूज द नेटवर्क and different applications. Okay, network ka network aur internet ko use karne ke liye users ko jo interface provide karte hain wo application layer ka kaam hai. Interface means is case mein interface kya hai, the interface is your, let us say you are using WhatsApp application, to WhatsApp mein jo aapka chat box rehta hai, that is the interface. Because user, as a user point of view, I'm not talking about machine, as a user, I am a user, I'm going to use the internet. So what interface? I must use an interface to use the internet. So that interface is the chat box of the WhatsApp. जैसे Facebook में use करता हूँ तो मेरे लिए interface क्या है, मेरा browser है. Browser के through मैं पहले Facebook जाता हूँ. अगर मेरे पास Facebook app नहीं है तो I can use browser, I can type in the address bar facebook.com. Okay, then only I can use the application Facebook. So all, if I want to use YouTube, again I have to use my browser and I have to put my address of YouTube and I can use the YouTube. So yahan pe jo browser aapka ek interface ho gaya, aur aap jo address bar likhte hain wo aapka ek interface ho gaya jisme user internet ki service ko use kar sakta hai. So application layer provides the interface for the user to use different applications over the internet. Okay, so these are the seven layer things. A lot of things aur bhi kafi cheez hai. Next classes mein hum bahut discussion karenge. Ab time ho gaya hai. If you have any question, you can raise your question. Still we will continue the very very essential and crucial part of this OSI model. It has not yet stopped. We'll discuss that how different layers can be implemented in a different, you know, in the TCP/IP model. Actually OSI model is the reference model, but प्रैक्टिकली जो मॉडल आज मार्केट में इम्प्लीमेंट होता है नेटवर्क के लिए वो TCP/IP मॉडल है. और कैसे हम डिफरेंट लेयर्स की फंक्शनलिटी को इम्प्लीमेंट करते हैं, कौन कौन सी लेयर को, लेयर में हार्डवेयर डिवाइस यूज करेंगे, कौन से लेयर का फंक्शनलिटीज को हम थ्रू सॉफ्टवेयर इम्प्लीमेंट करेंगे, वो सब के बारे में हमें नेक्स्ट क्लास में वी विल डिस्कस इन अ डिटेल वे. ओके, सो लेट्स रेज एनी क्वेश्चन इफ यू हैव, आई विल आंसर दिस.
Okay, thank you Dwivedi sir. We got some questions and we will discuss now. First okay. Question is basic difference between modem, router and switch, their applicability.
Okay, actually I have planned for a separate class for internetworking devices, but if you have raised this question in this class, I'll just give you a simple, you know, primary differences of these devices. Okay, so modem is nothing but a modulator. Modulator means just to convert the, you know, your signals, your digital signals to analog signals. Okay, that is why we can use this modem. Okay, switch is a again networking device which is required to connect computers in a network. So in a LAN connection, basically when we form a network, we need a switch. Like in the topology we have discussed about star topology. In the star topology we have discussed that there is a central, you know, hub where the systems are connected. That central hub may be a switch. So inside a network, or we can to form a LAN, of some computers, we can use a switch. Okay, but routers, when we are trying to connect two different networks, then we can use a router. For example, inside the OSU, we have two different labs, one lab. So the systems in that lab are connected to a switch because the systems are forming a single network. Okay, but if that system is somehow want to connect to the internet, then we must take the help of a router, because in that case we want to communicate with some other network. So two different, when there is a requirement of connecting two different network, then we may use a router. And when we try to form a single network of some computers, then we can connect the system through a switch. This is the fundamental difference of a switch and router. We will discuss that a switch is called an L2 device because it is conforming the functions as per the OSI model that we have studied today. It works in the layer 2. Layer 2 is called our data link layer. That's how a switch is called the L2 device. We have already discussed what are the functionality of a data link layer. So all these functionalities are being done by the switch. So a switch is called a L2 device, whereas a router is called a L3 device. Whenever you go to a market, you can purchase a router by saying the vendor that I need a L3 switch. Nowadays, the routers are also called L3 switch. So L3 switch means it is working in the network layer of the OSI model. So network layer functionality is already we have discussed today. So network layer is responsible for internet working, that is connection of network to network. Okay, so for connecting two different network, we may use a router. The practical example is, again, if you want to use, connect your OSI network to the internet, you must have a router. Okay, then only you can connect your OSU network to the internet. Okay, so connecting two different network, we need the router. And inside a network, if you want to connect the systems, we need a switch. Thanks.
Okay, sir. Many thanks. Then next questions. Very interesting. Two types of questions. I will merge it. What is IP address and how IP address help us? Very nice question, sir.
How IP address?
What is IP address?
Yes.
And
yes.
How it help us?
Okay. As I have told you that IP address is a part of, again, network functionalities. Okay. Whenever a device, network device, is connected to a network, it is given a 32-bit address. And that is called the IP address. जब भी आप कोई भी डिवाइस नेटवर्क में कनेक्ट होते हैं तो आपको आपका नेटवर्क जो है एक 32-bit IP address assign करता है. Okay, तो इसको क्यों assign करता है? Because आपके डिवाइस को uniquely identify किया जाएगा. Suppose पर अभी मिलियंस ऑफ डिवाइस आप एक नेटवर्क में कनेक्ट है या फिर इंटरनेट में कनेक्ट है, तो अब ये सारे डिवाइस को आप यूनिकली कैसे पहचानोगे? व्हाट इज द एड्रेस फॉर द डिवाइसेस सो दैट दिस डिवाइसेस कैन बी यूनिकली आइडेंटिफाइड बाय इधर ए नेटवर्क स्विच और ए राउटर. पहचानेंगे कौन? हम नहीं पहचानेंगे, पहचानेगा एक नेटवर्किंग डिवाइस. मैंने अभी बोला था कि दो डिफरेंट नेटवर्क को कनेक्ट करने के लिए हमें राउटर चाहिए और एक सिंगल नेटवर्क में डिवाइसेस को कनेक्ट करने के लिए हमें स्विच चाहिए. तो स्विच के साथ जब राउटर में जब आपका डिवाइस कनेक्ट होता है तो आपका राउटर आपको एक आईपी एड्रेस असाइन करता है. क्योंकि राउटर 50 डिवाइसेस को कनेक्ट किया है तो सारे डिवाइस को यूनिकली आइडेंटिफाई करने के लिए राउटर आईपी एड्रेस देता है. तो इसमें क्या होगा, मैंने अभी बोला था नेटवर्क जो आपका लेयर है वो सोर्स टू डेस्टिनेशन डिलीवरी करता है. तो जब राउटर के पास इंफॉर्मेशन आ गया, ओके, एंड वो अभी देखेगा कि मेरे अंडर में 50 सिस्टम है, तो ये इंफॉर्मेशन किस डिवाइस को आया है, तो वो क्या करेगा, वो डाटा का हेडर में आईपी एड्रेस लिखा होता है. जो डाटा राउटर के पास आया होता है उसमें आईपी एड्रेस होता है, वो पहले आईपी एड्रेस को देखेगा और उस आईपी एड्रेस जिस सिस्टम को असाइन किया गया होगा उस सिस्टम को वो इंफॉर्मेशन भेज देगा. सो इंफॉर्मेशन भेजने के लिए राउटर वो आईपी एड्रेस को यूज करता है सो दैट कि वो एग्जैक्ट लोकेशन में और एग्जैक्ट सिस्टम को वो आईपी एड्रेस वो इंफॉर्मेशन को भेज सकता है. दैट इज व्हाट आईपी एड्रेस इज रिक्वायर्ड टू यूनिकली आइडेंटिफाई अ सिस्टम व्हिच इज कनेक्टेड टू अ नेटवर्क. आई गेस यू आर क्लियर विथ दिस आंसर.
ओके थैंक यू सर. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज व्हिच टू लेयर्स ऑफ ओएसआई मॉडल आर
यस
नॉट ऑपरेटिव इन रियलिटी.
एक्चुअली आई हैव ऑलरेडी मेंशनड यू दैट द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन पार्ट ऑफ ईच लेयर आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास. द ओएसआई मॉडल इज अ रेफरेंस मॉडल फॉर योर काइंड इंफॉर्मेशन एंड टीसीपीआईपी मॉडल इज द एक्चुअल इम्प्लीमेंटेशन मॉडल. वी विल डिस्कस दैट. इन द टीसीपीआईपी मॉडल वी विल सी वी हैव ओनली फोर लेयर्स. ओके सो वी हैव ओमिटेड थ्री लेयर्स और नॉट ओमिटेड एग्जैक्टली वी हैव मर्ज्ड द एप्लीकेशंस प्रोवाइडेड बाय द डिफरेंट लेयर्स ऑफ ओएसआई मॉडल. वी हैव मर्ज्ड इट. हाउ वी मर्ज्ड इट? फॉर एग्जाम्पल फिजिकल लेयर एंड डेटा लिंक लेयर आर मर्ज्ड इन द टीसीपीआईपी मॉडल एंड दे आर टोल्ड एज होस्ट टू नेटवर्क लेयर. आर यू गेटिंग? तो फंक्शनलिटी ऑफ डेटा लिंक लेयर एंड फिजिकल लेयर आर मर्ज्ड इन वन लेयर. इट इज कॉल्ड होस्ट टू नेटवर्क लेयर. ओके देन फंक्शनलिटी ऑफ नेटवर्क लेयर इन द ओएसआई मॉडल द नेटवर्क लेयर ऑफ ओएसआई मॉडल इज रेफर्ड एज योर इंटरनेट लेयर इन केस ऑफ योर टीसीपीआईपी मॉडल. ओके नाउ ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर इज इंटैक्ट इन बोथ द मॉडल. ओके बट द अपर थ्री लेयर्स दैट इज योर सेशन लेयर प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर एंड एप्लीकेशन लेयर दीज थ्री लेयर्स आर मर्ज्ड एंड इट इज नोन एज ओनली एप्लीकेशन लेयर. So in the practical implementation, we have only four layers. That is application layer, then transport layer, then internet layer, then host to network layer. These are the implemented layer actually. So हमने जो session layer और presentation layer और application layer की functionality पढ़े हैं वो ज्यादातर हम application layer में जब भी हम कोई apps बनाते हैं. लेट्स टेक एग्जाम्पल ऑफ योर व्हाट्सएप. व्हाट्सएप एक एप्लीकेशन है. ओके सो ये व्हाट्सएप एप्लीकेशन क्या करता है कि वो रिमोट कनेक्शंस करवाता है और हम एक दूसरे के साथ चैट करते हैं. सो चैटिंग इज नथिंग बट रिमोट कनेक्शंस. रिमोटली हम एक्सेस एक दूसरे के इंफॉर्मेशन को एक्सेस करते हैं. तो हमने क्या पढ़ा था कि एप्लीकेशन लेयर हमको ओएसआई में पढ़ा ओएसआई में हम पढ़ा था कि एप्लीकेशन लेयर हमको एक इंटरफेस प्रोवाइड करता है तो हम एक एप्लीकेशन को यूज कर सकते हैं. ठीक है व्हाट्सएप हमें एक एप्लीकेशन इंटरफेस प्रोवाइड करता है जिसमें हम मैसेज लिखते हैं. ओके उसके बाद हमने प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर में क्या पढ़ा था? प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर हमको एनक्रिप्शन प्रोवाइड करता है कि हम एनक्रिप्शन करेंगे जो भी हम डेटा भेजते हैं वो एनक्रिप्टेड फॉर्मेट में जाएगा. आप अभी व्हाट्सएप में मार करना व्हाट्सएप में आप जब मैसेज भेजते हैं वहां पर लिखा होता है एंड टू एंड एनक्रिप्शन. ये आपका आप मार्क किए होंगे शायद व्हाट्सएप में एंड टू एंड एनक्रिप्शन. सो इसमें क्या हो गया कि आपका एंड टू एंड एनक्रिप्शन जो कि प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर में हम पढ़े थे ओएसआई में अभी वो उसका प्रैक्टिकल इंप्लीमेंटेशन में क्या हो गया जो आपने एप्स बनाया है उसमें आपने एंड टू एंड एनक्रिप्शन रखे हैं. सो द प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर का जितनी फंक्शनलिटी है वो अभी व्हाट्सएप में जो एप्स बनाया है प्रोग्राम किया है उसमें ऑलरेडी इंप्लीमेंटेड हो गया है. सेशन लेयर का जो एप्लीकेशन है कि मेंटेनिंग सेशंस मेंटेनिंग चेक पॉइंट्स डाउनलोडिंग करता है ब्रेक वाइज लेता है और रिज्यूम कैंसिल पॉज वो जो इतने ऑपरेशंस होता है ऑल दीज आर दी पार्ट्स ऑल दीज फंक्शनलिटीज आर इंप्लीमेंटेड व्हाइल यू आर डिजाइनिंग दी एप्स. सो व्हाट्सएप जब आप बनाते हैं या फिर यूट्यूब एक एप्लीकेशन है जब बनाते हैं तो ये सारा जो हम फंक्शनलिटी पढ़े हैं एप्लीकेशन लेयर प्रेजेंटेशन और सेशन लेयर की फंक्शनलिटी वो आपकी जब आपने यूट्यूब और व्हाट्सएप की एप्लीकेशन डिजाइन की थी जो सॉफ्टवेयर इंजीनियर्स ने डिजाइन की थी ये सारे फंक्शनलिटी वो रखे हैं. दैट्स व्हाई ये तीन लेयर को हम सॉफ्टवेयर लेयर भी कहते हैं. ओके ओएसआई मॉडल की जो फर्स्ट जो जो टॉप की जो थ्री लेयर्स है उसको सॉफ्टवेयर लेयर कहा जाता है और जो नीचे की जो तीन लेयर है फिजिकल लेयर डाटा लिंक लेयर नेटवर्क लेयर इनको हम हार्डवेयर लेयर ही कहते हैं. क्योंकि जितनी हार्डवेयर डिवाइसेस हैं जैसे हमने बोला था कि कंपोनेंट्स आपका इंटरफेस है जो RJ45 कनेक्टर जिसमें आप लगाते हैं आपका केबलिंग जितना है वो सारी हार्डवेयर कंपोनेंट्स है. तो फिजिकल लेयर डेटा लिंक लेयर की जितनी भी आपकी फंक्शनलिटीज है वो इम्प्लीमेंट हुए हैं हार्डवेयर डिवाइसेस के थ्रू. ओके, नेटवर्क लेयर में हम देखेंगे, देखो डेटा लिंक लेयर में हम देखेंगे स्विच यूज किया जाता है, और नेटवर्क लेयर में देखेंगे राउटर यूज किया जाता है. सो नेटवर्क एंड डेटा लिंक एंड फिजिकल लेयर की जो इम्प्लीमेंटेशन है वो हार्डवेयर इम्प्लीमेंटेशन होता है, इसलिए ये तीन लेयर को हम हार्डवेयर लेयर भी कहते हैं. सो यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड दैट कि एक्चुअल फिजिकल एक्चुअल जो इम्प्लीमेंटेशन होते हैं हमारे चार लेयर होते हैं, होस्ट टू नेटवर्क लेयर, ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर, सॉरी होस्ट टू नेटवर्क, इंटरनेट, ट्रांसपोर्ट एंड एप्लीकेशन लेयर. सो एप्लीकेशन सॉरी सो इम्प्लीमेंटेशन वाइज टीसीपी मॉडल में ये चार लेयर हैं, और बाकी की जो लेयर आप बोलते हो कि वो ओमिट किए गए हैं, वो ओमिट नहीं किए गए हैं, वो एक्चुअली मर्ज किए गए हैं. ओके, आई गेस यू गॉट योर आंसर.
ओके, थैंक यू सर, वेरी नाइस एंड सिंपली टू डिस्क्राइब द क्वेश्चंस. आई रिक्वेस्ट टू डियर लर्नर, इफ एनी क्वेश्चंस प्लीज डायरेक्टली इंटरैक्ट विथ आवर दियोजी सर. प्लीज अनम्यूट योर माइक एंड आस्क टू डायरेक्टली आवर दियोजी सर, अदरवाइज वी आर क्लोज दिस सेशन हियर. Okay, no.
I will share the slides for this lecture. Actually, I have read the slide.
Please.
Unfortunately, I didn't go through that slide. I'll definitely share the slide. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you, Divedi sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Himadri sir, and our learners. We will our session. Please. Closed here. Okay, thank you all.
Okay. Thank you all.